Good evening, everyone. My name is Reverend Marvin Silver. I serve as the Associate Conference Minister for the Justice and Witness Action Network of the Central Atlantic Conference. And I'm very happy that you have decided to join us this evening for our Build Power 2022 Organizing and Strategy Retreat that will be held this evening from 6 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. and also tomorrow, Saturday, December 3rd, from 8:30 a.m., starting off with some coffee and conversations, and we will carry on until about 12 p.m. So again, thank you for your time this evening. Let us jump right in. I'm going to turn it over to my new colleague here on the Central Atlantic Conference ministry team, Reverend Craig Peterson, to open us up with a brief word of introduction and a word of prayer. Craig?
Thank you, Marvin. I just got home about 15 minutes ago from a root canal. So if I'm a little spacey, give me a little grace, I hope. But I'm thrilled to be a part of the ministry team, thrilled to be here this evening. And with that, I would invite us to take a few deep breaths, enter the space of prayer, and I'll open us. Gracious God, in this season of Advent, we are even more mindful of what it means to live in the now and the not yet, to live with the hope of what could be, but to face daily challenges that remind us of painful realities. So in our time together, may we draw strength from you, certainly, but from one another as we summon the courage and the strength to go on, as we name the challenges and the defeats that linger, but always, always, always find our way back to the promise of what will be. And may we listen for that promise through the words, the experiences, and the space shared together. For the chance to go on this journey tonight in a season of journeying, we give thanks in the name of this coming Christ child, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Craig, and thank you for being faithful to join us this evening, even in the midst of a little bit of pain and the root canal. So thank you very much, and thank you for that beautiful prayer. We want to start out this evening. For those of you who just joined, feel free to introduce yourself in the chat. Give us your name, your local church, and hopefully you also know your association as relates to the Central Atlantic Conference. We want to start out this evening as we try to do at this point in the year when we gather leaders, clergy, and representatives from local churches across the network. Is to remind you who we are and to proclaim our vision as a new movement of the Central Atlantic Conference. So give me one moment while I share my screen and take a few moments to share with you. So the Justice and Witness Action Network, we are a justice movement of local churches, of clergy and justice leaders, building and organizing power to secure a just and compassionate world for all. So this is why it's important that this evening we have entitled our retreat and for tomorrow, Build Power, because that is at the core of what we are doing as a justice movement. The network, for those who do not know, it serves as the primary arm for the conference to carry out our vision and mission for justice and witness ministry. And when I say the conference, I don't know what visual you have in your mind, but when I say the conference, it's not just me, my colleague Craig, Sharissa, and Freeman, and others who are on the staff of the Central Atlantic Conference. It's every one of you. You are the Central Atlantic Conference. The network also trains and educates and engages members in community organizing. We're going to be doing a lot of that in this retreat, grassroots advocacy, and shaping public policy that advances our vision of securing a just and compassionate world for all. Our work is grounded in a biblical understanding of justice, of resolutions that have come through our conference and General Synods of the United Church of Christ, is also consonant with our UCC historic witness, what we understand and mean by prophetic ministry in action, and a set of guiding principles to define our witness. And we'll get to those guiding principles in a moment. We are building a powerful, faithful, and impactful, we like to say, organizing network that engages each of you in community organizing, grassroots advocacy, prophetic witness in action, civic engagement, and political action and shaping public policy. And we are happy that that work continues and has started as far back as 2019. So this is our logo. For those of you who may have been seeing our image for the past 3 years, we felt it was important for us to sort of solidify who we are as a emerging organization of the Central Atlantic Conference. And you can learn more about us as well online. We have a website and we have a number of key campaigns that we have been engaged in since throughout this year, rather, that you can learn a little bit more about at your leisure, as well as if you are here tonight, you've already joined the Justice and Witness Action Network, because just by the very fact that you RSVP'd for this retreat, you are now a part of the list, you are part of the community, and we hope that you will stay engaged and get plugged into the work that is taking place. And this is our presence online, on Facebook, on that social app that many of us are dreading that even exists right now. And then we're also on YouTube. We have a number of our recordings from training sessions on YouTube as well that are available for your use. So this is our vision. And I've essentially already communicated that, but we like to lift this up to remind ourselves of who we are and what we are working towards. This is a process of becoming as a movement, as a organization. Our mission, which we've already communicated, is simple. We are building a powerful, faithful, and impactful organizing network of leaders, clergy, and local churches across the Central Atlantic Conference. Not only does our vision and our mission define our identity and shape how we approach the work of justice, but it is these guiding principles. At the heart of what we do is being theologically and biblically grounded, rooted in the theology of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the biblical concept of justice and peace. We also want to be self-determined. That means defining our own agenda, setting our priorities based upon our historic witness, the needs of those impacted people by injustice, and also doing this based upon a power analysis, being informed about what power is present, what power is impacting God's people in a way that's not fitting with building of God's beloved community. And what does it take for us to be engaged in that work and to use our collective power to bring about change? We also want to embrace the concept and what I like to call the art of community organizing. Some prescribe to a particular understanding or style of community organizing. I tend to believe that there's truth and wisdom and effectiveness in all. And at the heart of any community organizing work or strategy or philosophy is building lasting power and organizing with and for the self-interest of the poor and the oppressed towards a common vision of justice and community. We also want to grab hold of and continue to live into that biblical understanding of what it means to be prophetic in our witness and our action. So that's boldly speaking truth to power and engaging in action that holds that power accountable. And then finally, let's not deny the fact that there are so many other gifts within our community as a people of faith, as a public, such as music and arts, that can really shape and define our identity, helps us to preserve our stories, and energizes our actions and also helps to sort of lead the way. So there's space for those of you who have a passion to do the work of justice, but also bring that gifting of music and arts. we want to be strategic in our approach as well. We don't want to just jump from one issue to another issue and not be effective, even in our campaigns, without being strategic in our approach and efforts. And then finally, as I like to say, no one organization, no one person can do the work of justice alone. So we must do this work through coalition and partnerships, working with organizations with common goals and an agenda for collective power and action. So this is who we are as a justice and witness action network. Members, for the work that we have been doing since 2019, members collectively organize and advocate on a variety of issues, or have done that since 2019. And members are part of the network, have an opportunity to be in collaborative relationship with other UCC advocates in their state and their local community. And that's made evident by some of the emerging state and regional action networks where you have a chance to learn a little bit more about this evening and also tomorrow. We're still in the process of building a central conference leadership team that would help to sort of resource and provide coordination support for the work overall. But tonight, I would be remiss if I didn't say thank you to the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee, who sort of stepped into the gap to sort of serve in that vision, that role of being a central team to help shape and build the Justice Witness Action Network today. So thank you to the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee. And then just to just sort of give you just a quick preview, this is one of our state action networks. And I like to call it the Justice and Witness Action Network Virginia. We have one in Washington, D.C., although Washington, D.C. is not a state. We like to call it one of our regional action networks. We hope to have an emerging network in the state of Maryland, although there has been some work amongst churches, leaders, and clergy in Maryland. We haven't risen to the point where we have a organizing team populated with leaders from our churches in that state who are facilitating and coordinating the work of justice as a whole. Then there's New Jersey, and we also have some other states that make up the conference structure. Delaware oftentimes feels a little slighted when we don't include them, but that is one state where we're also hoping to do some work, even though we have just a few churches there. These are some of our issue-based networks. Those top three there, you have a chance to learn a little bit more about tonight, and those are some that are more active and engaged. The three at the bottom are ones that we do have in the network, particularly our Palestine and Israel network. We need to get them more plugged in to the work that's happening across the conference and to gauge our churches and leaders a little bit more. We know that we have a significant number of churches and people who are committed to LGBTQAI plus issues. And then we also know that many of our churches across the conference have been engaged in immigration and sanctuary work. So we list those there because we think those are important issues to lift up as potential networks that we would build in the future to come. Let me just stop sharing for a moment and move past this point because we're running a little bit behind our agenda. But you have a sense of who we are as a Justice and Witness Action Network. We wanted to be sure to share that this evening, partly because we know that some of you have not heard this presentation or have seen this information a little bit more in depth. But what I would like to do right now is shift our focus and conversation to a key part of our power building that's important for us to be effective as a collective whole, as a network. So I'm going to turn it over to Reverend Lindsay Franklin, who is the chair of the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee, to lead us through the next portion of our time together.
Great. Thanks, Marvin. And as you said, I'm Reverend Lindsay Franklin. I'm chair of the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee. And it's been a true joy to be in this work alongside all of you. So I'm going to share my screen, and we're going to be talking about the key kind of building block of organizing, which is the one-on-one. So I wanted to start just talking about, and this is likely old hat to many of you, but I think it's important to name, just that the source of power in community organizing, obviously as people of faith, the source of our power is in God, right? That's foundational. But the source of power in community organizing is in relationships. And that power comes from the people and relationships between and among the people, and that creates and generates this bottom-up power. And so obviously, you know, the relationships are the core of our faith. So start with the words of Jesus. I give you a new commandment, love one another. Just as I have loved you, you must also love one another. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. So loving one another, being in relationship with one another, obviously, as we know, love is what justice looks like, or justice is what love looks like in public, and that loving one another and the power in relationship is the core source of organizing work. So now I'm going to turn it over to actually Bishop Royster, who Bishop Dwayne Royster led a whole our previous organizing training through this, the Justice and Witness Action Network, was all about one-on-ones, and we're just going to get a little snippet of it tonight. But we've taken a recording from, we've just got 10 minutes of this recording, and then we'll kind of go more deeply into it. But this is Bishop Royster from an organizing training last year that was all totally focused on one-on-ones. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Bishop Royster. This is about 9 minutes, and then I'll take it from there.
So the next thing that we're going to talk about in our collective work together is the issue of one-to-ones and building relationships. So relationships are how we build our capital, right? This is how we build our capacity to do our work, build our capacity to build power, right? Organized people plus organized money equals organized power. Again, organized people from plus organized money equals organized power. And the way that we build relationships with people, this foundational element is called doing a one-to-one. So a reminder, faith-based community organizing equips people with skills and capacity to effectively enter public life in order to negotiate their interests and values. And I think that's important for us to be reminded of all the time, that like this is a public relationship. And although we're going to be talking about one-to-ones here in a minute, and we'll be talking about one-to-ones that you do with another person, a lot of times the relationships that we're talking about building in those, it's not necessarily about building friendships or getting a best friend or something like that. This is about entering into a public relationship, a conversation about shared interests that could actually have the capacity to transform your community. It's a very intentional conversation. It's a very intentional meeting of the minds when you come together. So Cornel West says, justice is what love looks like in public. Dr. Cornel West, who's now at Union Seminary in New York City, used to be at Harvard and used to be at Princeton as well. And then Francis of Assisi says, preach the gospel every day, and if necessary, use words. And I think it's important for us to understand that even when we're building these relationships, even how we're showing up, how we're sitting, how we're talking, how we're engaging, speaks volumes about what we do. Power is the product of relationship. And we should be able to say that you can't move somebody if you're not in relationship with them, whether it's a public official, a corporation, a person sitting next to you in a pew. You've got to be in relationship with them somehow or another to move them. Relationships are ultimately about who do you love, who are the people that you love that help you to dictate who you actually need to be in relationship with. We always say, when in doubt, do a one-to-one. If you're not sure about something, somebody says something, does something, whatever, you go back, have an intentional conversation with them. And the real way that we build power is to stay close to our people. Whenever we move away from each other, we move away from the base of people that we've built, we actually wind up hurting ourselves and hurting the community that we're really trying to impact. So I want to talk about conversations. So most conversations that we have with people, I refer to as a top of the water iceberg conversations. And this image before you kind of shows this notion, right? So only 10% of an iceberg is above the water. 90% of an iceberg is below the water and you normally can't see it. Most of the time when we're engaging people in everyday life, you know, just engaging in conversation with them, we're doing that 10% conversation. Hey, how's the family? How's the kids? How's work? How are things at church? You know, how is the ministry going? Things of that nature, very generic questions that we all ask each other every day. We sit at coffee with one another, have these conversations, the coffee class that you have after church, right? They're not necessarily the most deep, meaningful conversations in the world. When we do a one-to-one conversation with somebody, our goal is actually to get down below the surface, to find out really what they're thinking, what they're feeling, what's going on inside of them, right? We're really trying to ask some very pointed questions that hopefully we're asking questions and also sharing vulnerability that allows, give space for people to open up and share with us in a deeper way what their concerns are, what are the things that, you know, that they keep them up at night. It's one of the questions we're gonna talk about, what keeps you up at night? Adam Kruger, who actually now works for National People's Action, used to work for Faith in Action, says your one-to-ones are a direct referendum on the amount of love you have for your community. So the number of one-to-ones that you do is a direct reflection on how much you actually care and love the people that you're in community with. If you don't want to talk to them, you probably don't love them very much. If you want to talk to them, find out what motivates them, what makes them tick, what keeps them up at night, what makes them have hopes and dreams for the future, then you're going to spend time dealing with one-to-ones and having heart-to-heart deep conversations with them. If you're going to build a faith-based community organizing network, which is, I think, what Justice Witness Action Network is trying to do, the one-to-one is the most critical organizing skill you have to master. You have to be a master doing it. And again, it's not just any old conversation. It's actually a very intentional conversation, very focused in on what you are talking and sharing, both sharing and listening for in others. And I like to say one-to-ones are an organizer's superpower. Yes, I'm a black nerd or a blurred, as we refer to ourselves. I'm really into the Marvel Universe and superheroes and comic books because I grew up on all that stuff. And so superpowers become very important. And so having good quality one-to-ones are an organizer's superpower, right? Because it builds that emotional, mental fabric between people that gives you the strength to go into battle with one another and to be able to get victory. So one-to-ones build relationships, power, they build tension. We'll talk about that a little bit. Leadership, build agency, build around scope of work, build results, build story, and they build team, right? All these things happen at one time or another in the course of building out a one-to-one relationship. Again, remember, we said the first revolution is internal. Sometimes you got to do a one-to-one with yourself. Ask yourself some of these questions so you have some answers and a story to talk about. But we want to make sure that people understand that these one-to-one conversations are looking to do some very definitive things, like some of the things that are listed here. And we should say, just so everybody, in case you might be trying to take notes, we're going to make these slides available to folks that you can go back through and look at them whenever you have the time and energy to do so. So there's more than one type of one-to-one. There's relational one-to-one, which we're actually going to talk about today, but there's leadership one-to-one, a challenging one-to-one, debriefing one-to-one, inspirational one-to-one, a testing ideas one-to-one thinking with, or a coaching and mentoring. And they all come at different times in different places. And you know, they can be used for different things. For the purposes of what we're talking about right now, we're trying to build a relational one-to-one. Some of the other one-to-ones that we talked about, though, are more advanced, right? So you don't do the advanced ones without first having a set of relational one-to-ones that are building depth. And we want to say that, right? You can't have intention one-to-one with somebody if you don't first have a relationship with them, or agitational one-to-one with somebody when you don't first have a relationship with them. You need to build relationship and capacity to be able to talk about this. This goes back to Reverend Franklin's conversation earlier about white folk in this space, or men dealing with women in this space, right? Before you can actually have deeper conversations with folk, that where you're pushing them or, you know, trying to get them to see things a certain way, you've got to build some trust with them. And that happens over a series of relational one-to-ones where you're actually learning about them, they're learning about you, and you are growing together. So here's a couple of questions I like to ask when doing a one-to-one. And we should say a one-to-one should be no more than 30 to 45 minutes. You want to respect people's time when you do these, especially in the earlier stages. If people want to know that you're going to come in, come back out, you're going to honor their time. But, you know, other than, you know, you do some of the preliminary questions and things, but you want to ask questions that really get below the surface, that make people stop and think. Questions like, what keeps you up at night? If money wasn't an obstacle, what would you fix first and why in your community? When you think about your community, what is the one issue that if you fixed it would transform the neighborhood for the better? You know, things like, you know, at this moment, you know, in COVID, what are you most concerned about for your children? Questions like that, that really aren't just superficial, but are actually going beneath the surface and really, you know, getting to the heart of what makes people tick, right? What makes them think? What keeps them up at night? What do they wake up early in the morning wrestling with? What are their souls wrestling with when they get going in the day?
So that was Bishop Royster talking about the one-on-one. And it's funny, every single time I listen back to that training, I learn more and I realize how important these are. And I'm gonna get a little bit into the how of it. And actually what if in our folder that is shared with you, you'll see a 40-minute version of that video. And he actually does a model of a one-on-one with Reverend Silver here and kind of then picks apart, you know, how it worked, how he was able to do the one-on-one. We don't have time for that tonight, but I think just giving you a little taste of that. One of the things that he also talks about is that again, these aren't just relationship building for relationship's sake, right? It's relationship building so that we can build power to one another, with one another. And so in the context of the Justice and Witness Action Network, this is a little graphic that helped me think through kind of where we can use the one-on-one. So if you think of the one-on-one as this building block of a relationship between two people, you'll get a little bit more of this later today or tonight and tomorrow, but within, as Reverend Silver referenced, within the Justice and Witness Action Network, we have our regional action network. So both the state and region of Maryland, DC, New Jersey, Virginia, et cetera. And so the one-on-ones are a really good way to build out those regional networks, right? So like you want to build out a regional network, you bring people in by having one-on-ones. Also a key piece to this are the church that I didn't have in here, but church justice and witness action networks as well. But you think of the one-on-one as kind of the building block, then you kind of use the one-on-one to build out a community of people doing work together. And then eventually, and then also we can use the one-on-one to bridge kind of our regional work and then our issue-based work to make sure that we're all in relationship with one another. And then thinking about our coalition partners, right? Within our regional action networks, we have coalition partners. So I'll just, for instance, you'll hear a little bit more about the Virginia Regional Action Network. They've had a relationship with the Virginia Interfaith Center for Public Policy. That's a coalition partner. That you know, we can use the one-on-one to build out those partnerships. So then once you start to look at this, you kind of see a network and you see that the one-on-ones are really the glue of the organizing network. I also want to just say, and as I was listening to Bishop Royster, he gave this training a year ago. And I will just own that I have not done any one-on-ones. And it's such a simple tool that we forget. It's staring at us in the face. You know, we host Zoom calls for our regional action-based networks. And we do all of this work in groups and we prepare and we pray and we work, but we kind of forget about the core building block of the one-on-ones, which is why we're reiterating it today. So what we're gonna do now, it is 6:37, and for the next half an hour, we are going to get into groups of three, and you all are going to practice doing a little bit of a one-on-one together. So the how Bishop Royster described the one-on-one was you, kind of the basic overview was you kind of greet each other, you kind of find some, you know, I think in the example with Marvin, he asked about his kids, et cetera. There's kind of some greeting. And then the icebreaker, which kind of gets below the surface, I chose this question from the ones that he talked about, which is, what is one issue that really keeps you up at night? What is one issue that really keeps you up at night? And that's what we're gonna really focus, because you'll only have 10 minutes per conversation. If you just get to the greeting and the icebreaker, that's okay. We're not modeling perfect one-on-ones here. The kind of if you did have a full half an hour, 45 minutes, how it would be is you do the greeting, the icebreaker, then you kind of make a connection between yourself and the issue and kind of find kind of any common ground between those. Deepen into curiosity about why that issue is so important or what kind of going even deeper, and then an invitation to action. And so whether that's meeting an introduction to someone else or to kind of any kind of way that this conversation could lead to action. Again, you're just getting a little snippet of it. If you want to see the whole training from last year, I invite you to watch it. Given time, we'll just do 30 minutes and you're going to have three 10-minute conversations. So if you really, we're going to really want to keep you on time. So in your group of three, you will be part of two conversations, and then you'll observe one. So in the first conversation, one person will be the leader who will be driving the conversation. One will be the participant who will be receiving, and then there'll be one reserve observer. And then we'll switch and you'll kind of go around, and then we'll switch again and you'll go around again. And we'll chat at 10-minute intervals. So you'll have to keep time, and you'll want to keep going, because these kind of intimate conversations tend to go, but you'll need to stop and switch to the next so that we can kind of keep moving. Welcome back, everyone. So we're gonna go on break and be on time at 7:15, which is great, we're on time. But in our last 3 minutes, I just love, put in the chat, and if you feel so led by the spirit to pop in, to voice it out loud, what went well? What do you learn? What was hard?
I thought we all had similar concerns and related to mostly the situation in our country right now and how do we live with that. But one of the things that I liked about it was that we all sort of, we built on each other's, we referred to each other. We sort of built our little community in that.
I love that you used the word build, right? That's how power builds. Yeah. We build on each other's story and relationship. What else? We also see in the chat similar shared interests, shared concerns, active listening.
Well, in the group I was in, we ended by saying how wonderful this process was, and that if we don't hold back and if we're not afraid to use it, we will find that we do all have shared spots that we can relate to and can build on and can support each other. And then we had a pastor in the group who was inspired to maybe use this one-on-one process with the congregation. And so it has implications beyond that. My own observation was when I was being the observer, I got so engrossed in the conversation, I completely forgot my role as an observer. And I listened though, I didn't break in. But you find that these varied interests and issues and what have you will bring you together. They will just absolutely bring you together.
Great. There's some awesome stuff coming on in the chat. Any other folks want to voice anything aloud before we break?
Yeah, I wanted to say something about the group that that I was with, Dr. Diane and Gail. The training, that short tidbit of a training that we got from Bishop Royster, they really listened. They talked about being really intentional, because that was in there. And they actually, in the introductions between the two, they talked about what was what kept them up at night, and their respective passions and what they're interested in, and exchange numbers so that they can do some work. So I thought that was really cool.
Amen. Thank you. It's also even just like the difference between when we went into the one-on-ones, just, and obviously it's hard to feel energy on a Zoom call, but like the energy prior to going into the one-on-ones, it's, you know, 6:15 on a Saturday or on a Friday, we're like tired and what are we doing? But I can feel your all's energy, right? And like that also is power building. And that also is what strengthens and coheres our coalitions and our movements. So really grateful for all of you for diving in with us on that. And now we're actually right on time to have a 15-minute break. So we're gonna, you can get up, stretch, turn off your screens, you know, do just kind of light a candle, decompress, do whatever you need to do. And we're gonna come back at 7:30. So thank you, thank you, thank you all.
So welcome back. Welcome back from the break. Let us continue. We have about an hour left in our time together, and we want to spend a little bit of time introducing to some of you for the first time, and others to maybe learn a little bit more about the issue-based networks of the Justice and Witness Action Network. We're going to hear from three of our leaders. I'll be sharing a little bit about our racial justice network. You'll be hearing from John Cassander, who will share a little bit about our environmental climate justice network. And I'm also happy that we have another one of our environmental climate justice network leaders, and Robin Lewis, here with us this evening. She also represents Interfaith Power and Light, DMV. And then Minister Keisha Monroe will finish up with introduction of our Voting Rights Advancement and Democracy Network. And then after those presentations, we're going to have some time to go into small groups around each of those networks for you to engage us in further conversations about what do we need to do or accomplish to build power in the context of those networks. So let us begin. I will share my screen. So our racial justice network is a issue-based network. The Justice and Witness Action Network as a whole, it was one of our first issue-based networks. We began our work back in 2018, and I'm proud that I was not the initiator of this network. It was a number of leaders in our local churches across the conference who was recognizing that there's more that we need to do as the church in regards to racial justice. As you know, a lot have been happening in and around the country on racial injustice, and several leaders came together to want to explore what is it that we can do in our local churches to advance the issue of racial justice. So that work began with several leaders, and I'm gonna try to remember them all by name. One of them is with us this evening, Dr. Vivian Jackson. Thank you for your leadership in our racial justice network. We had several others like Reverend Ann Holmes, Reverend Jerry Han Berry. We've had also a few others as well who are escaping me, but those names will come back to me. But those leaders gathered together with me being present, not all of the time, to really discuss what would it look like for us to do the work of racial justice in our local churches. And one of the first things we did was to put together a training session. We wanted to build off of the great work that was coming out of our national offices around the white privilege curriculum and other resources to really build sort of a base of leaders in our local churches who are having these conversations, but to support them in leading these conversations in their local church and hopefully move forward with some additional work. We then had a subsequent training in the fall of 2019 with Reverend Dr. Velda Love as our lead facilitator. She is our National Minister for Racial Justice out of the Justice and Local Church Ministries. And it was a great opportunity to not only have her with us, but to learn from the work that she had been doing around the sacred conversation in racism. Some of the goals and the strategies that that initial core set of leaders came together to work on included the need for us to build anti-racist local churches. And what do we needed to do that? We needed to sort of normalize conversations around race, racism, and white supremacy. We needed to develop a framework for racial justice in our local churches. And we needed to build the leadership and capacity in local churches for the work to be organized and to be facilitated. We also wanted to look at organizing some association-based racial justice teams. We do have some association racial justice teams in the conference, Potomac, Catoctin Association in particular. And then we wanted to make the work of racial justice a priority for the Central Atlantic Conference. Continuing with that last point, we were able to do that by in the conference's strategic action plan, racial justice was one of our goals, strategic action initiatives for the conference as a whole. So these are some of the actions overall that we built on out of the conference's strategic action plan. How do we develop a process for journeying into anti-racism for our local churches? How do we implement cultural diversity training? This builds off of resolutions that came out of, I believe it was the Michigan conference, requiring authorized ministers to have anti-racism and cultural diversity training in order to maintain their standing as a minister in the UCC. We wanted to build off some resolutions that we had worked on as a conference. We wanted to normalize conversations on racism, racial justice rather, and we wanted to hire some social justice community ministers, as we called them at that time, but essentially organizers. And we wanted to try to organize a legislative campaign. Moving on, just try to give you some quick updates on some of the things we accomplished out of those strategic actions. So one of the main ways in which we are doing our racial justice work in the conference is we redeveloped an anti-racist local church audit under the leadership of Dr. Vivian Jackson. It has been tested in two of our churches, and we've also conducted a focus group with one of our churches. And we now have a finished product that's being designed so that we can begin to work closely with our local churches who are interested in beginning that journey. We held several workshops and trainings over the last few years on what it would look like to confront racism within the in the church, particularly around the audit, and to give a preview of what the audit looks like and how that fits into our larger work. We've had conversations with leaders across the conference. And then again, we've had about a dozen leaders who have participated in the National UCC Sacred Conversation to End Racism to be facilitators around the work of racial justice. Moving quickly around that strategic goal, number three, we worked closely with MESA back in 2018 to develop some resources around the resolution that we passed in the conference and took to General Synod in 2017 that speaks to the challenges that historically underrepresented groups, particularly those who are clergy, have in serving as senior minister in many of our churches. And we also did some preliminary work by meeting some of the goals within our conference about sharing information on how we're working on that resolution. And we continue to do that work in our search and call process by supporting our churches, exposing them to cultural diversity and racism, what it looks like to consider candidates who are essentially non-white or not male for their senior minister positions. Moving on quickly, We did some work around strategic action number four. We held some trainings in 2019 and continue to do that in 2020 through association spring and fall meetings, as well as through the conference annual meeting. We were happy that some of the trainings actually came out of the work from our racial justice organizers, one of which was done by Sarah Ramslin, who's a student at Lancaster Theological Seminary. She did a training around My Grandmother's Hands, racialized trauma and the pathway to mending our hearts and bodies. And we also had a particular training session that was exclusive to for people of color, particularly people of African descent. So sort of begin to sort of deal with how do we deal with sort of the racial trauma of everyday racism, microaggressions, et cetera, et cetera. Moving on, and then strategic action number five. Again, Sarah Ramslin was one of our racial justice organizers back in 2021, as well as Minister Keisha Monroe. This was part of their field placement work to complete their seminary education at Lancaster Theological Seminary. So we do have a relationship with them and provide opportunities for students to work with us through our Justice and Women's Action Network. And then finally, we did a survey back in the summer of 2021, trying to see where, the possibility of doing a federal issues campaign. Since we're uniquely located here, our nation's capital, we've had conversations early on about what would it look like for us as the UCC in this region to serve as the grassroots presence in Washington, D.C. for national movements, mobilizations, for federal campaigns. And about a third of the network voted at that time when we were at about 500 members on our list, and they voted for voting rights advancement, combating voter suppression as a federal issue. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as we move into the new year. And finally, we're still trying to figure out how to move forward around the cultural diversity training for clergy. The ministry team is going to be focusing on that early next year in terms of our plans moving forward. You may have heard about a resolution that came out of the Potomac Association not too long ago that came to the conference annual meeting back in 2021 that we passed. The racial justice group, the Potomac Association, is continuing to work on that. They're doing some implementation around that. And one of the ways they're implementing that is developing a Disrupt White Supremacy, Set the Church Right resource and process to implement this resolution. And we're happy that the resolution has been presented to the UCC General Senate staff, to the resolution committee process, and it's going to be considered as possibly moving forward to General Senate in 2023 next year. So that is the racial justice network. And when we have an opportunity to get into our small group time after the next two presentations, we'll be answering that question: what do we need to accomplish and do in order to build power as a network, as well as some other questions that are specific to racial justice issues. But we wanted to give you sort of a quick overview of that network. What I want to do right now is move to our next network. And I have a video that I'm going to play from John Kassinger. He is also a seminary student at Lancaster Theological Seminary. And we're excited that he's brought his passion for environmental and climate justice, as well as his skill set in community organizing, to help us with building this network. And he's partnering and working closely with Robin Lewis and our partners at University of Maryland around building this network based upon a pilot initiative. So I'll stop and let him share a little bit more through a recording. He's in class tonight, but he had a chance to record his session so that we can learn a little bit more.
Get into it and start working our way through what we've been up to this past year and where we're taking it in the year to come. But before we do that, I want to provide a brief introduction for those of you who might not be aware as to who the Environmental and Climate Justice Network is, what we do, what our focus is, what it is we're trying to accomplish, all that good stuff. So I pulled a little excerpt from our website because I think it sums it up really nicely. The Environmental and Climate Justice Network of the Justice and Witness Action Network calls on local churches, clergy, and justice leaders across the Central Atlantic Conference to join us in the work of tending to God's world and the people in it through the struggle for environmental and climate justice. Now, I think it might be easy to write off environmental work as hippie stuff, but I do want to situate this within the history of the broader UCC's justice movement. The first real environmental work that the denomination engaged in was the product of work done by the Commission on Racial Justice back in the late 70s, the early 80s. Ben Chavis and Leon White were involved in a movement down in North Carolina to prevent a toxic waste dump from being brought into a predominantly Black community on the basis that it was a predominantly Black community. It was sort of an understood reality that they were bringing the bad stuff there because of who lived there. And so they organize they're involved in the organization of a civil disobedience movement. A bunch of people, you know, chain themselves to equipment and they lie down in the road and they all get arrested. And while they're unable to stop the dump from being put in place in the first place, it does provide the spark that would produce a report a couple of years later called Toxic Waste and Race, which was a groundbreaking piece of, you know, community science work that demonstrated that it's not a unique problem to that North Carolina community. It's a general problem across the US that if you are a person of color, you live in a community that is in much closer proximity to toxic waste, to dangerous levels of pollution, to, you know, things that are damaging to the human condition and are gonna shorten your lifespan simply by virtue of the fact that the US government is racist as all get out. And they allow this sort of stuff to go on. And so they start using the term environmental racism to define what it is that's going on there. And their environmental justice work comes from that perspective, that there are certain people in the country who are on the receiving end of a sort of racist violence and discrimination. And it's our duty as people of faith to protect those people, to work to rectify the situation, to work to tend not only to the earth that's being hurt, but to God's children who are being, you know, maimed and killed on a daily basis by the gross inaction of a state that should be invested in their protection. And so we're continuing in that tradition. And our work in 2022 is in that same spirit, taking a look at where it is that air pollution is worse, why it might be worse there in particular, and trying to map that out on a community level, because while the EPA does try really hard to keep an eye on this sort of thing, they're hamstrung a little bit by their own limited resources. And so community science is one of the ways that we can fill in the gaps where they might exist, and then take that data that we gather with us, the legislative process, to try to push for change. So what is it that we did in 2022? We started the Air Quality Data Collaborative partnership between the Justice and Witness Action Network, the DMV branch of Interfaith Power and Light, and the University of Maryland's Center for Community Engagement, Environmental Justice and Health. So what we did during the course of that is take signups for congregations that were interested in hosting an air monitor. And you can see one of the devices down there in the bottom right corner of that slide. They're Purple Air branded. I don't know if that rings any bells. They're the ones that Weather Underground uses to try to keep track of what amount of particulate matters in the air, what the general air quality is for a given day. And we had around about 20 congregations enroll to receive a monitor that they would host on their property and absorb some of the responsibility for monitoring the condition of it. They don't have to do repairs necessarily. The folks from UMD are pretty capable of doing that. They want to try to protect us from having to get up on a ladder if we don't have to, that sort of thing. We're in the process right now of doing site reviews of those individual church properties to figure out, you know, where's best, what kind of wind do we get passing through, because you want to get good airflow through where you have the monitor situated. You don't want to put it like right over a parking lot because that's going to skew your results, that sort of thing. With an eye toward carrying through on the installation come the new year. So in the interim, over the course of the fall, we had a community science and community organizing workshop series led by Reverend Silver and myself and the community science and environmental science more broadly experts from SIEJ. So we did a 9-part series. Tonight is technically part 10 for those of you who are here and were involved in that, because we're going to be covering a lot of that community organizing stuff. And the course of those workshops covered the basics for air quality monitoring. What is it that we're actually testing for? Why is it that it's important to test for that stuff? Like, what's the difference between PM2.5 and other sorts of particulate matter in the air? What are the health consequences, that sort of thing? What are the tools we use to measure for those things? How are we best served to take those measurements and communicate them to people so that they're meaningful for them? It's all well and good to know that the PM2.5 level is out of control in your neighborhood this week, but you got to know what that means and how it is that you can respond to that adequately as a member of the community in order for that to be meaningful information. And so far, I think it's been very fruitful. I think it's been a really good experience for the people involved. I know that I have certainly learned a great deal, and I fancied myself a pretty knowledgeable person on the question of environmental justice. So if that doesn't tell you something, we're trying to focus in 2023 on building power and figuring out what that looks like for the networks individually and collectively, figuring out how it is people think that it's best to go about that. Because I mean, at the end of the day, this is a community organizing effort and you guys are the community, or at the very least representatives thereof. So we don't want to dictate terms. We want to allow folks to determine what it is that matters to them, what it is they want to pursue, and then facilitate pursuing those goals. If you are on the Chesapeake Bay and it really eats you up that the water's getting poisoned and the wildlife is suffering, that's great. How do we work on that? How do we get you some joy at the State House in Annapolis? How do we go about making it so that your concerns are addressed and the problems that you have identified are, while maybe still problems, less severe problems? I don't want to suppose that we can, you know, put on our Superman cape and solve everything in the world, but we can get some forward progress on work toward making sure that it's less of a concern and it's less of a problem and it's not doing nearly as much damage. Harm reduction is a perfectly valid thing to pursue as a social justice end. So what do we have on the books for 2023? Like I said, we're working on expanding the air quality monitoring network into New Jersey, specifically the area surrounding New York City, because that's where we seem to have the greatest body of volunteers and where it seems like it's going to be the most sensible to gather that data, since it's going to reveal some impactful statistics. Beyond that, we're going to work on completing installations in our existing Maryland and DC congregations so that we can start recording and sharing data with our friends at UMD and our congregants more broadly. Because as important as it is to support the science, it's also important to let people know what's going on where they live. And so beyond that, what we're doing next year really depends on you guys. And so I want to hear from you. To go back to the Chesapeake, is that a thing that's really eating people up? And that's something that we should work on in 2023. You know, I don't really know. for the benefit of the tape, I live in suburban Baltimore and I'm a fairly recent transplant. So I have a general idea of what's going on. I have a general idea of where there are problem situations. But if you lived here for 20, 30 years, you know so much better than I do. And I really would benefit from hearing your thoughts on the matter and where you think it is that we should be targeting our efforts to try to have the greatest impact on the lives that people are living in the greater Central Atlantic region. So that's about all I have to say. That's my update on the network. So with that, I will let you guys get back to what you've been doing. And I thank you for your time.
All right. So what we will do right now, thank you, John. What we will do right now is we will hear from Keisha Monroe, who will give you sort of a quick update on the Voting Rights Advancement and Democracy Network. And when she's completed, I'll share a little bit more information about our group time. Keisha, you want to share your own PowerPoint or you want me to share it?
Oh, I'll share it.
Right. Go ahead.
I'll try to share it. Hold on 1 second. Okay.
There you go.
Hi, everybody. I'm Keisha Monroe, Minister Keisha Monroe, and I am the 2022 Faith and Democracy Campaign Organizer. And I was not part of this campaign in 2020, so I didn't actually go all the way back to bring you guys up to speed. I'm just going to talk about what we did this year. What is the Faith and Democracy Campaign? So faith and democracy pull together the two concepts that are at the heart of Christian work. It's work rooted in the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are called as the priesthood of all believers to look into the gospel that liberates and serves as a framework for anti-oppression work. Our vision is to empower and organize the work of justice through coordinated federal, state, and issue-based community organizing with justice leaders, clergy, and local churches of the Central Atlantic Conference of the United Church of Christ to secure a just and compassionate world for all. So what we do is we organize under the banner of faith. We're working on expanding the number of leaders and strengthening our relationships. And the work, the action work, is to advocate for federal and state policy initiatives. What I also would like to tell you all is that utilizing the church to coalesce and organize under the banner of faith to fight the systems of oppression and injustice needs to be done in our political system, because policy is how systems are created and upheld, which is why voting, voter engagement, and voter education is so important, and why it's such a strong push for our campaign. So being in contact with the members of your church to keep them informed of what is happening outside the walls of the church, and being in relationship with your elected officials, as well as in relationship with other churches, and definitely in relationship with us, the leaders of the initiatives, it's really important in building the power that we're so looking to do in the future. But the most important thing is your relationship with God, and how you understand Christ should be your impetus to do the faith and democracy work, and not just the work that you are personally interested in, but the work of oppression, anti-oppression work in general. So our focus initiatives for 2022 was basically outreach and coalition building and helping churches to, build up their own programs. There were a lot of materials that were sent out. If you just access them through the Google Drive, there was a lot of information that gave you step-by-step what you could do in order to be engaged in this work. We initially started the federal campaign to work on voter suppression laws based on a survey that Reverend Silver had talked about, but it was stalled in Congress in September of 2021. This was like just after the survey was done and the decision was made. It was stalled in the Senate and it's still sitting there. So that's something that that needs work. We also worked on voter education and empowerment for the churches, hoping that the churches would put together programs in order to educate their congregations on who the officials were, who the elected officials were, what the voting dates were for the primary and the general election, and to empower people to work with other people in their own immediate environment to get people out to vote. We also did work with people to get voter registration done. There was a 30-day get out the vote campaign for the last 30 days before the election. There was a plan to do a Juneteenth Sunday celebration, which also fell on Father's Day. So it didn't end up doing that. And there was a Faith and Democracy Sunday liturgy and worship resource packet that was made available to the churches to use on Faith and Democracy Sunday, which is every year. This year was September 11th. I think it's like the second Sunday in September. So the events that actually took place were the Poor People's Campaign March to the Polls and Rally. And the rally took place at People's Congregational Church in Washington, D.C. And Reverend Dr. Stephen Gray was the speaker. And the YouTube video to the right was attached so that when you all get a copy of this, you can go back and click on it and take a look. It's like a great movie. You don't want to give it away. I really just want you all to just like sit down, take it all in, because Reverend Ray gave a call to the people of the United Church of Christ that will get in your soul and your spirit and just push you into getting the work done. And the Poor People's Low Wage Workers Assembly, we did a rally at Reverend Hindler Voss's church. I can't remember the name of her church. Christ Congregation?
No. First Congregational.
I'm sorry?
First Congregational.
Yes, First Congregational. Yes, 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 yes. And we marched down to the Capitol. So that was a good rally. That was a good rally. We also had churches doing postcarding with the Center for Common Ground. They provided a great source of information and training and materials to be able to reach out to churches, not only in our conference, but in Virginia, in Texas, in Georgia, I think Alabama, and one other state. That's a very popular activity, and it was very successful, and we're glad that people participated. And so we want to get that same sort of energy around some of the other events. We also, like I mentioned before, did a get out and vote push. And one of the public witness events was one of the churches down in Virginia did Souls to the Polls with NAACP in Virginia. I can't remember the name of the church right now. I'm so sorry. If you're on the call, I'm sorry, but you can give yourself a shout out when this is all over with. But I thought that was really cool. Some of the churches did voter registration drives, not very many. But that's something that we can work on as a source of building power, is to do some more voter registration drives. And Prophetic Voices of Justice was put together. And I think maybe five pastors from around the conference did some videos that were released about particular issues that are of interest to the that are of interest just generally. And we also did Faith and Democracy Sunday. So one of the most important things that Bishop Royster talked about were the one-on-ones, and Reverend Silver and Reverend Franklin all talked about building relationships. United Church of Christ is very well known for its covenants, which we are built on. Everything is about covenant in the United Church of Christ. And so we need to do more organizing around coalition covenants. We as a conference need to work together to build this coalition in order to build the power, because we all know there's strength in numbers, and we all need to not just focus on the issues that are most passionate to us. I know after that the presentation that was before me, if I didn't have so many other passions in this work, I would definitely be right with John to do his work. But the idea is to be able to go and do the environmental work, to be able to go and do the racial justice work, to be able to go and do the work with the Palestine, Israel, and LGBTQ, not just ours. So if somebody calls, then we all just run. And so that's what I mean by organizing around coalition covenants. Utilizing campaign materials for use in the churches. There is an enormous amount of material that is there for the use for the Faith and Democracy campaign, for all of the campaigns. But I know that Reverend Silver has worked like incredibly hard to pull together the materials, the manuals, the liturgies. It's right there for you. And so if you just utilize those materials, I think that's a great way to sort of push this movement forward. People attending events. I don't have the numbers in front of me. I know that there are 30 people on this call. It would be nice if we had 130 people on this call. So yeah, call your friends, tell them to get on the next call. Creating opportunities for church members to do justice work. That's something that we are gonna start working a little bit more with churches. Even though the materials are there, the training opportunities that come from the conference level, we are open and available and ready and willing to help the churches pull the justice work together, or even help you pull together your social justice ministries, or whatever, however you title the justice work that happens in your church. We're willing to help with the training to help you pull that together. One of the other things I think we ran into is there's an assumption by the churches that some work doesn't need to be done, because they assume that other people are doing the work as well. And that's not always true. And I mentioned this before, showing up because I need you, or the network, the particular issue-based networks need you, and not just because you're interested in that particular issue. So I think these are all things that need attention and can help build power. And I think I'm almost done. So building coalition covenants is just identify and the people in your churches who are passionate about justice and strategic and identify strategic partners like other UCC churches, organize trainings and events focused on justice and set goals and timelines, and then launch. Contact the Faith and Democracy organizer for assistance to launch your 2024 campaign, because that is going to be some work and questions and answers. And we can sort of talk about some of the questions in our breakout rooms.
All right. Thank you, Keisha. So I know we went through that pretty quickly to share with you the work of the issue-based networks. If you stop sharing your screen, Keisha.
Oh, sorry.
And then we can move to the small groups. We want to try to spend 15 minutes in each of the sessions. And again, the central question that you're going to be asking is, what do we need to do or accomplish to build power for this work of this network? I'll be leading the conversation for the Racial Justice Network. Robin Lewis, who's serving in dual role. She's one of our own UCC leaders. She's a member of Beloved Community, one of our online-based churches. And again, she's also staff director over at Interfaith Power Light DMV. She'll be leading the Environmental Climate Justice Network conversation. And Keisha will be leading the Voting Rights Advancement and Democracy session. So those will be the three groups. You have an opportunity to self-select. We'll take about 15 minutes to be in conversation to ask that central question, as well as two specific additional questions related to that network, so that we can get your voice, your perspective on building this work moving forward. So let me open up the rooms and you will self-select. So where you feel passionate about one of these issues, or where you feel that your local church likely would like to engage in a set of work.
That was a great ending for our group.
I agree.
That was much too short. I thought that was going to be much, much longer.
Well, we're trying to honor the time and not keep people too late. We didn't want to go to 9 o'clock, but know that this is just the beginning of the conversation. And what I would encourage our leaders of these networks to do is to put your contact information in the chat, as well as your connection to the network, and people can grab that information. We'll be sure to populate the Google Drive with the contact information and current leaders of our network, so that for those of you who are here tonight can reach out to them to learn more about the work that they have been doing and what we need to do moving into 2023 to continue to build our power to be effective to do that work around that particular issue. The reality is, you know, we're not called to be single issue leaders, right? Although we have passions based upon what moves us to action, what has touched our heart, but also maybe even experience we may have had in our upbringing or currently in our community, or that we're just concerned about. The reality is we're called to be a people of justice, not just racial justice, not just environmental justice, et cetera, et cetera. And that's important for us as a network, as we build power, because as we do this work collectively in this region, and particularly in our state regions from time to time and around these issues, we want to bring the totality of who we are, not just a piece of our movement, of our membership, when we need to respond and be the church in partnership with those who we are working closely with. I just want to provide an opportunity for any just sort of brief comments or observations from the issue-based network conversations. Robin, anything you want to share and lift up from the environmental and climate justice?
I have so much. My goodness. So, you know, just we touched on solar, we touched on air, we touched on just water. I mean, just all the things, you know, overburdened, underserved communities, you know, just everything you could think of. And we just got a lot of work, guys. We got, so I will share my notes for sure.
Great. Anything, Keisha, that you want to lift up real quick before we prepare to end our time?
Yeah, I think it's really important to send out the material, like the organizing manual, and just be super clear about how people can get the material, get engaged, understand exactly what it is that the Faith and Democracy group actually does. Because I think people are signed up, but they don't know how to access the materials.
Right.
And I said, like, you know, it's been going out. So I said, well, maybe, I'm not sure what's going on with that, but we just need to make sure that they're getting the materials. So that was one thing. The other thing is just, you know, trying to engage, having the conversation about engaging communities outside of your immediate zone.
Right. Great, great. And one of the things that came up out of our session is the need for us to do more racial justice one-on-one with many of our churches. When you talk about the journey of anti-racism, we have churches who are along a spectrum. We have churches who are at the beginning stages of just exploring, you know, what does it mean to be anti-racist? And we have churches who have done some intentional hard work and they're ready to engage one of our resources like the Anti-Racism Local Church Audit. And then also, how do we make sure that the work of justice is not just sort of a side component of our local church ministry and ministry as a conference, but how is it sort of infused throughout our collective ministry as a church? And I'll close with this, that, you know, everything we do through the Justice and Witness Action Network, we try our best to do it through the lens of racial justice. It is 8:32 right now. I want to thank you all for spending time with us this evening. I see Lindsay, she has another announcement. And I think after her announcement, we're going to ask Robin to give us some final words in the prayer.
Bridget, go for it.
Okay, Bridget from Plymouth in DC. And I put information in the chat. Just so you know, if you're not totally worn out tomorrow and you are DC-based or focused on DC, we're having a Housing Justice Assembly hosted by Plymouth tomorrow at 2 p.m. At the church. There's event information in that link and a link to register. So we're going to be doing action strategy and action planning. We've got some great speakers, including the DC council member for our ward who has introduced the Green New Deal for social housing. And it's an awesome, awesome, awesome piece of legislation. So would love to have y'all come out if you are DC based or interested. Thanks.
Thank you. We are in the planning season. We appreciate our Justice and Witness Action Network, Washington DC, focusing on housing justice as their issue over the last year or 2 years now, and they've been doing some great work. Robin, we'll turn it over to you for a final word and closing prayer.
Well, thank you. I actually had to pray about what I was going to say, so I had to put it down on paper so I could say it the way God gave it to me. So let us pray. God, I ask you to use us as faith leaders in the fight for justice, to voice your word and share the knowledge that you have blessed us with on this very important topic of building power through our working with our communities to advocate for justice. You've shown us repeatedly that we are responsible for not only caring for our earth, but ensuring that we are considering others in our faith walk. Lord, let this workshop compel us to work together with our impacted brothers and sisters to seek out solutions to the racial, economic, social, and environmental injustices that we all know that they face. We ask for the strength to be unified as a unified front, as one community of believers who are doing the work of organizing and advocacy together, not separated or separate or disconnected from each other. Only working together collectively and inclusively? Can we build power to fight against injustice? Help our churches see themselves as part of the whole and engage in this work as active partners with each other in the community that they serve. We asked that you give us the wisdom to let go of our hidden agendas and rather adopt your collective focus and make sure that we do all that we can to bring all who are in need to the table of justice. Lord, put in our hearts your sense of justice and let it shine through us as we do the work that you have destined for us to do. Therefore, as people of faith, trying to do what is right by each other, we seek strength to stand up for justice and inclusion, no matter what. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. Enjoy.
Amen.
Amen.
We'll see you tomorrow morning for those who want to join us at 8:30 for some coffee time on you and conversations. And then we'll start our time at 9 o'clock with worship. Thank you all for joining this evening.
Thank you.
Amen.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Reverend Marvin Silver. I serve as the Associate Conference Minister with the Central Atlantic Conference and the Director of our Justice and Witness Action Network. Thank you for joining day two of our Build Power 2022 Organizing and Strategy Retreat. This morning, we are going to begin with worship. So I would encourage you, if you haven't done so already, please introduce yourself in the chat. Give us your name, your local church, and your association within the Central Atlantic Conference. And then if you can also change your name on your screen to add the abbreviation of the state where you're located. This is for our future, our work later this morning. Thank you so much. Let us begin worship.
Let us pray. It is a time to get ready. Loving God, get us ready for what is to come. Ready and renew our minds. Ready and renew our hearts. Loving God, ready and renew our souls for the work of justice. Ready our path ahead, O God, towards you and towards one another, as we seek to follow the steps laid by your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture for this morning is taken from Romans 12, verses 1 through 5. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, on the basis of God's mercy, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable act of worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members, and not all members have the same function. So we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually, we are members of one of another. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Before we begin with our guest preacher, I know that it's oftentimes difficult to sing on Zoom because we hear all of the different voices. But I was in a choir once. I believe I can hold a tune, and I don't think it's nowhere near fair to have a preacher preach before they are led by the Spirit into preaching with a song. So the song that's on my spirit this morning is, I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed
on Jesus.
Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 One more time. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 We give God thanks and praise this morning for the spirit of music, but we give God thanks and praise for our brother in Christ, Elder Robert. He likes to be lovingly called Bobby Faison. I met this brother years ago, when he joined the Potomac Association Board of Directors. He was at the time the executive minister of Community Church of Washington, D.C. He still serves in that role. And there was just something about his spirit. He has a loving spirit, a caring spirit, a spirit to want to be engaged and connected with God's people. He loves God. He wants to serve God. And in fact, he is on the journey to become an ordained minister in the United Church of Christ. And I learned much about him as he matriculated through the Potomac Association, serving on the board of directors, and then ultimately becoming the moderator of the board of directors. And he and I worked very closely together to call the Potomac Association to live more deeper and greater into what it means to be a covenant body of Christ. And it was because of his efforts that this association has grown in many, many ways to where we are today as the Potomac Association. But not only that, I would say that that underpinning, that foundation that was laid to build covenant, I think supported the work that that has gone on in the area of justice in terms of where we are as a Justice and Witness Action Network across the Central Atlantic Conference. So I'm glad to see that he has responded to the call to say yes to God, to be an ordained minister. He is also serving as the Minister of Faith Formation and Mission over at Emmaus United Church of Christ. And he is a student at Wesley Theological Seminary. I believe he is in his second year. So you pray for him as he continues to move forward with his studies, and pray for him this morning as we ask God to speak to him and through him to bring forth a word that would inspire and to convict us to live more deeply in who we are called to be, and that is a people of God and a people of justice. Let us welcome our brother in Christ, Elder Bobby Faison.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Reverend Marvin, or as you like to be affectionately called, Marvin. Thank you as well. I was looking around to find out where this Robert Bobby Faison was that you've said all these accolades about. So, I said, oh, that is me, isn't it? So indeed, thank you. I again extend thanks to you, Reverend Marvin Silver, to Reverend Lindsay Franklin, and to all of the expressions of justice and witness that are assembled here today. Whether you're DC, Virginia, or Maryland, it's good to see you. I too recognize some familiar faces. I remember some of you from the conference as well. I remember some of you from our fall meeting, for the Potomac Association as well. I remember specifically, I remember Vivia Jackson from meeting her at that meeting. I think I owe her a phone call too. So that seeing your face reminded me of that today. And again, to each of you and to the Central Atlantic Conference, I know we're representatives of the CAC are here today and the Potomac Association. So indeed, I'm honored to see each of you and thank you for the invite. I do bring you greetings on behalf of the Community Church of Washington, D.C., United Church of Christ, where our newly installed senior pastor is Reverend Adalphe Johnson. Formerly, the pastor was Reverend Dr., and he's now the pastor emeritus, Reverend Dr. Aaron B. Wade. I also bring you greetings on behalf of Emmaus United Church of Christ, where the senior minister there is Reverend Kristen McBrayer. So as a preacher, we always want to make sure that we give honor to whom honor is due. So now that I have done that, let's pray. So God, thank you for this time that you've allowed for us to come together. Speak to me and speak through me. God, may you be glorified and may the people be edified for your glory and for your honor, and then to be a blessing to the people that you've entrusted to me in this moment and in this season. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Amen. So as we gather this morning, I want to start off with a illustration or a poem that I think speaks to where we are today. And the illustration goes as follows. And I think it's very apropos because it's a Christmas poem or Christmas illustration. It says, "The Cost of Christmas." One person observed that the message of Christmas was not one of convenience, but cost. It cost Mary and Joseph the comforts of home to take a long journey to Bethlehem while she was very pregnant with her new child. It cost the shepherds their comfort by the campfire and the ease of their shepherd's life, answering the call to the manger, and then the conviction to tell others the good news. It cost the wise men a long journey and expensive gifts and changed lives. Ultimately, it cost the early apostles and the early church persecution and sometimes death. It cost missionaries of Christ untold suffering and loss to spread the good news. It cost Christian martyrs of all ages their lives for the sake of Christ. More than all of this, it cost God the Father, his own Son. God sent God's Son to the earth to save humanity. It cost Jesus a life of sacrifice and service and a cruel and horrible death. The Christmas message is ultimately one of cost, not of convenience. And so, and as I looked at that particular point today, in preparation for today's sermon, I realized and was reminded that there is indeed a cost to serve God. And I think it's very fitting to go along with the scripture that was previously shared. Thank you, Ms. Vivian, for doing that, and how it relates to the homily for today. Again, as I said, there's a cost to serving God. There's a cost to doing the work of justice and witness. And some of you can testify to that. There's a cost in walking in the call that God has for you as an individual, as part of an organization, as part of a local church, a committee, or a team. In many cases, there is indeed benefits to serving as well. So I don't want to downplay or dismiss those. We as human beings are cool with the benefits. We love and look forward to perks for doing what we do. We get involved in most things because we're looking for the bennies, the benefits. Very seldom does one say, "No, thank you. No, thank you. No, I don't want the benefits. No, thank you. No perks for me, please. Girl, will you take those blessings away from me? I don't want none of that. Bruh, I appreciate the offer for the benefits, but you know what? I'm not really interested in the benefits. I don't want them." Seldom will you ever hear someone say those comments. Conversely, seldom does one say and mean it with their whole heart, that they will give up this or give up that, and you fill in the blank for your this or your that, that you will give that this or that up for God or for something that God has called you to do. Now, some of you are going to say, you know what, Elder Faison, you don't know me like that. You don't know me like that. We never met in person. I seen you on Zoom, but you don't know me like that. Yeah, I know that I'm right on this. Because sometimes God will call you to pray, and the scriptures will even remind you, men ought always to pray, but you don't pray. Sometimes God may say, you know what, I want you to take some time and read my word. The Bible even goes as far as to say, study to show thyself approved, but you don't read your Bible. Sometimes God may call upon you or place upon your heart to give. And again, the Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you. But you don't give. You keep that money in your pocket. You don't give of your time. You don't give of your talents. And you don't give of your treasures. The reason why I know I'm right is because I've been in that same situation. There have been times when I haven't prayed, when I haven't read the Bible, when I haven't given what God has called me to do. And I thank God for God's forgiveness. But with each new day, we get a new opportunity to do things the way God would have us to do them. Realizing you don't do it because you know there's a cost. You know, you'd rather look at the football game. You'd rather be spending time with your family. You'd rather be out shopping. I understand those things do happen, but sometimes we are called to sacrifice some of that. I logged into Zoom this morning at Reverend Marvin's request to encourage you, to admonish you, to motivate you, to beg you, if I have to do what God has called you to do for the sake of the call. Now, for those of you that might be taking notes, that's the title of my homily, For the Sake of the Call. Now, it's my tradition to kind of give some definitions to make sure we're all on the same page. So the definition of the word for, F-O-R, is in support of or in favor of. An example, they voted for independence in the referendum. The definition of the word sake, S-A-K-E, for the purpose of, in the interest of, in order to achieve or preserve. Another definition, out of consideration for or in order to help someone else. And then the definition of call. Call, which is a common word acquiring theological significance when God or Christ is the one who calls, implies a divine election or a commission. Sometimes individuals are called to a special vocation. We can think of Moses. We can think of the judges, the prophets. All of those are examples of call, being called. Now, when I say called in our homily this morning, I'm not just talking about those that are called to be preachers, pastors, or serve in pulpit ministry. Even as I, as Reverend Marvin mentioned, as I believe I am called to pulpit ministry and to serve as a pastor, I'm not just talking about that today. There are multiple calls across people, and there are multiple calls within one person. Of course, our focus today is the call to the work of justice and witness. So the relevant question I have for you today is, why should I, or why should you, do what God has called you to do for the sake of the call? I'm glad you asked, and I do have an answer. The first reason why is because of preparation. God has already made preparation for each of us to walk in the call that God has for us. In our scripture passage, it says, I beseech you, and I urge you, therefore. The word therefore is critical here, because when there's a therefore there, then it's, you would want to ask the question of yourself, what is the therefore there for? So if we go back and look at Romans chapters 10 and 11, it gives us the answer of, it gives us the preparation that has occurred that will allow us and enable us to walk in the call that God has given to each of us. We find that in the previous chapters, that the Israelites, they had a zeal for God. They were energetic about doing the work of God, but it was not according to enlightened and being enlightened, as the scriptures say, meaning they didn't have the full understanding of what God was calling them to do. And sometimes we recognize that we may have a zeal for God to do the work that God has called us to do, but we may not have all the insight. We may not have all the understanding. But indeed, because we have that zeal, that can take us at least to a certain degree in doing the work that God has for us to do. And then also in previous chapters, we see that the word of God was near the people of Israel. They had been exposed to Jesus, the Israelites. They had been exposed to Jesus, the Christ. So that they knew something about the Holy One. And then it talks about the aspect of salvation, a real churchy word, which really just means having a relationship with God. And then it also talks about in those previous chapters about how the shame has been removed, because sin can and rebellion and disobedience and doing those things that, quote unquote, separate us from God, that can create a degree of shame. Sometimes we can even think about in our own lives when we know that God called us to do something, but then we don't do it. So we have a degree of shame. We have a degree of guilt for that. But and then we also see in previous chapters that the Israelites and the Gentiles, they were grafted in so that they could have that relationship with God. And so because of all that God had done, all that spirit, the divine, Jehovah, Yahweh, the creator had done, all of it was in preparation for us to gain direct access to God and the opportunity to present ourselves as living sacrifices to God. So we do the work that God has called us to do for the sake of the call, because God has already made the preparation. That means that God has already equipped us to do the work. So we don't have to wonder. We don't have to fret. We don't have to be fearful. We may need to get some more insight, but just having that confidence, having that assurance that God has already prepared you for the work should give us a motivation, should give us a desire to step out or to launch out into the deep, as Jesus the Christ said, to do the work for the sake of the call that God has for us. In addition to the preparation, there's also the purpose. There is a purpose in the call. God is not just calling us by happenstance. God is not just calling us because God has nothing better to do but to give us tasks to do. God has called, given us a purpose for the call and in the call. The purpose of the call, as we saw in our scripture this morning, is to present our bodies as living sacrifices acceptable unto God. That's what God has called us to do first and foremost. And so that looks like how we show up in our word and in deed. That's how we present ourselves, both verbally and in writing. That's tagging onto social media, because that's a ministry as well. And there is a way we're called to present our bodies as living sacrifice, even on social media. And then we think about that also means that's how we show up and how we present ourselves to God and to others in spirit, soul, and body. Notice that I covered all of them, because God calls us to present all of ourselves to God. So that's the other call. And then the purpose in the call is that once we present ourselves as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, which is our reasonable service, then we go out and do the service. That means that we have a commitment to ministry work that glorifies God and helps humanity. That could be justice work. That could be pulpit ministry. That could be community outreach. That could be business ownership. So again, God has prepared us for the sake of the call. God has given us purpose for the sake of the call. And finally, God has given us people for the sake of the call. We're not in this alone. We saw in our scripture passage this morning in verses 3, 4, 5, and actually even 6, it talks about the aspect that we are, first of all, we need to make sure that we don't think of ourselves more highly than we ought to. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't have a degree of self-esteem. That doesn't mean that we don't have confidence in ourselves. But what it does mean is that we're not arrogant about it, that we're not trying to showboat, that we're trying to be seen in all of it for the sake of being seen. God is calling us, or Paul is reminding us, I should say, in this passage, that we should not do that. Don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to. And I have learned over the years, and I'm a little old, that sometimes when you try to put yourself out there, and it's even a reminder that pride comes before the fall. That means that we've put ourselves out there. We've tried to make ourselves out to be more than what we are, that we haven't reached out to help reached out for help, or we haven't done something. And so what happens when we are prideful, when we think more highly of ourselves than we ought to, then a fall is somewhere down the line. So again, Paul encourages us that don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to. But then Paul goes on to say that realize that each person does have something that they are called to do. It says that it talks about the different, each person has, there are many people, many members, but there's one function within among the members and within the body of Christ. For as in one body, we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. So we are many members. All of us have a different function, but it all contributes to the one body. In this instance, the one body in Christ. So what does that say to us today in this 2022 understanding? It means that we should make sure that we stay in our own lane. Do what God has called you to do. God has not called me to do Reverend Marvin's job. God has not called Reverend Marvin to do my job. Reverend Marvin should stay in Reverend Marvin's lane. Elder Faison should stay in Elder Faison's lane. Keisha should stay in Keisha's lane. So we are called to do what God has called us to do, because each of us has a different function. But that does not negate the fact that we can have a two-lane highway, a four-lane highway, a six-lane highway, an eight-lane highway, a 20-lane highway, a 26-lane highway. And there really is a 26-lane highway. It's in Texas. But the point is, even as we stay in our own lines, that does not negate the fact that we in our different lanes can come together to make a super highway. And that's what God is calling us to do in many instances. Sometimes God may create that single lane that God wants you to walk on. There are times that there will be that single lane experience. And when God calls you to those, walk in those. But more often, God is calling us to walk in community within our organizations, within our churches, and within our justice work that we do. So, and we realize that there is strength in numbers. Time has taught me that as well. The Bible reminds us that every joint supplies to make the whole body function at maximum capacity. When one joint is not working correctly, then the whole body suffers. And when it's two joints, there's greater suffering. So the individual parts need to be functioning so that the entire body can function most effectively. What does that mean? That means that as individuals, we need to make sure we are doing self-care for ourselves. We need to make sure that while we're doing the justice work, while we're doing the ministry work, while we're doing whatever God has called us to do with our colleagues, with our siblings, make sure you take those times for self-care. Because as they say, if you don't have yourself together the way that you should be, then how can you be effective or most effective to help somebody else? So the individual parts need to be functioning so that the entire body can function most effectively. I'm reminded of the passage of scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 that talks about the different body parts and how the foot can't say, because I'm the hand, I don't need to be a part of the body. Or the ear can't say that, well, I don't need the eyes, because, and I'm paraphrasing, of course, because if the ear was the only thing that existed, then where would the sight be? If the mouth was the only thing that existed, then where would the walking be? So again, every joint supplies. And sometimes we have to celebrate what each person brings to the table as well. And that same passage of scripture talks about body parts that are less noticeable, that are not as popular as the ears and not as popular as the eyes. And that particular passage of scripture talks about the importance of those parts of our body are given even more honor, more prestige, so that all parts of the body have an equal significance, an equal importance to the function of the body. So we think about those persons that may be may have medical challenges, they still have value. They still have significance. Well, what if it's someone that may have a speech impediment? They still have value. They still have significance. Well, what if it's someone who has another challenge that prevents them from doing doing the largest part of the work? Whatever work that someone does, it still adds value. As I've also learned in life, every little bit helps. So whatever anyone can bring to the work that you're doing, that we're doing as a group, then we should celebrate those individuals. Everyone's not called to do the same thing, but everybody is called to do something. So there's a statement that I want to share with you. It actually comes from Walter Brueggemann, who is an American African. Walter Brueggemann, who is an American Protestant Old Testament scholar, and he's a theologian. This is what Brueggemann has to say. It is apparent to us that the churches and the culture of which we are a part are undergoing profound challenge, struggle, and change. We observe the end of dominant privileged positions of race, class, culture, and gender. Traditional centers of economic and political power have eroded, and now and new power structures are taking their place. So what I've learned and what I've devised over time from education, from just living life, from serving in ministry for a number of years, we live in what some have called a post-colonial world, but corporate and consumer economic forces and structures threaten new forms of domination. We must galvanize. We live in an increasingly global and multi-ethnic world, but we experience the wrenching violence of nationalist extremists and ethnic intolerance. We must strategize. We live with a new awareness of race, class, gender, and sexual orientation, but with growing expressions of intolerance and hatred directed at differences in the human community. We must depolarize. We live in a world grown smaller and more interested by virtue of travel and technology, but with increased divisions of wealth and poverty and growing crisis of environmental exploitation. We must mobilize. We live in a time of spiritual hunger, but with challenges to our spiritual integrity that arise out of self-interest and consumer values. We must sympathize. We live in a society with vast new opportunities to enrich the lives of families and children, but with increased pressures that sometimes break fragile family structures or put our children at risk. We must empathize. We live in a world plagued by terrorism, racism, sexism, and a whole lot of other isms. But we also live in a world where there are men, women, non-gender conforming people who will not stand idly by, who will no longer tolerate housing insecurity, food insecurity, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We must demarginalize. Sometimes we don't want to be the one on the front line. I get it, and I know, and I've been in that place as well. Sometimes we wonder, why me, God? Sometimes we say, well, they ain't doing it, so I'm not going to do it either. Or why do I have to do anything? Sometimes we say, it's still just the same three people doing the work. Marvin, Lindsay, Keisha. Next event, Marvin, Lindsay, Keisha. Next event, Marvin, Lindsay, Keisha. No, but for the sake of the call, I encourage you today to stand on the front line. For the sake of the call, I encourage you to stop questioning God and realize, why not me? Make a decision to stop worrying about what other people are not doing and stay focused on what you are called to do. Stop complaining about just three and be thankful that there are three, and be intentional about recruiting three more, then three more, then three more, until we have more people than work that needs to be done. for the sake of the call of justice, for the sake of the call of equality for all humankind, for the sake of the call that God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven, for the sake of the call to be a living sacrifice, which is our reasonable service to God and to the humanity that God has entrusted to each of us. There's a song from John Legend that says, if you hear this message, wherever you stand, I'm calling every woman, I'm calling every man. We're the generation, we can't afford to wait. The future started yesterday and we're already late. If you're out there, sing along with me because John Legend's a singer. If you're out there, I'm dying to believe that you're out there. Stand up and say it loud. If you're out there, tomorrow's starting now. And I believe because you are here, even in this moment, that there are people that are out there. There are men, there are women, there are gender non-conforming people that are out there. So let's stand up. Let's say it loud. Let's do the work that God has called us to do. And let's do it not only individually, when God may call us to do that, but even more so collectively. Let's synergize all that exists among us. We can do it. I've seen it happen. The association has benefited from synergy that has occurred in the past. Do the work that God has called you to do. Let us do the work that God has called us to do for the sake of the call, because we've been prepared. There is a purpose and there are people to walk the road with us. God bless you and amen.
As a child, this next performer played gospel piano from his grandmother. Today, he continues to use music as an instrument of faith and a way to praise the Spirit. He's partnered with nonprofit organizations to fight for an end to poverty and to develop the next generation of minority leaders who can carry the torch of philanthropy. Now that mission brings him to our stage tonight with a song that is a true call to action. Performing If You're Out There with the world famous Agape International Choir, please welcome John Legend.
If you hear this message, wherever you stand, I'm calling every woman, calling every man. This generation, we can't afford to wait. The future started yesterday, and we're already late. We've been looking for a song to sing. Search for a melody, search for someone to lead. We've been looking for the world to change. If you feel the same, then go on and say, if you're out there, sing along with me. If you're out there, I'm dying to believe that you're out there. Stand up and say it loud. Promises, no more call to war, unless it's love and peace that we're really fighting for. Oh, we can feast our hunger, we can conquer hate, put down the arms and raise your voice with joining hands today. Oh, I search for a leader. Say it loud if you're out there. If you hear this message, wherever you stand, I'm calling every woman, I'm calling every man. We're the generation, we can't afford to wait. The future started yesterday, and we're already late.
Thank you. As we deepen into this season of longing, know that there is power in our longing for justice. As we long for justice, we are called to prepare ourselves, to ready ourselves, to put cost over convenience, and step boldly into our call, knowing that God has prepared the way, preparing us with purpose, surrounding us with the people we need to do this work together. We are indeed not alone. So as we go into the next part of this day together, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and through you. May God's face turn towards you and give us justice and peace. Amen.
Amen.
So now, Marvin, I'm turning it back over to you.
Thank you. My apologies. I had my sound down. Let us move forward into the next phase of our time together this morning. And thank you. Thank you, Elder Faison, for that call to action, for that message that definitely has inspired. And I hope it has convicted many of us. And for those who are yet to watch this recording. So thank you, my brother. I love you. I appreciate you. Let us move forward right now, and we're going to spend a little bit of time sort of building off of what Elder Faison shared this morning in the context of his sermon. We are in the process as a Justice and Witness Action Network developing an organizing guide that is unique to our unique situation as an organization, as a church, as a justice movement. We are trying our best to respond to God's call to be a united and united people working for justice. As you all know, the United Church of Christ is well known among the faith community and many secular organizations as the Justice Church. Many of you are part of this branch of Zion because of our justice commitment, our historic witness on the work of justice. But at any moment in time, it is important to take a stock of where you are and who you are at a given moment. And it's important for us to sort of begin to measure ourselves in comparison to that historic witness that has come before us. You know, we claim to be a justice church and we claim to be a justice conference. And I ask myself all the time, is that true? Is that true? And I think that's an important question for us to ask in these times filled with so much hatred, so much turmoil, and so many who are experiencing the isms of this world. Now, prior to the fall of 2019, us as a conference, we did our justice work through a primary framework. And that was, you know, drafting, developing, and discussing resolutions and seeking passages of those resolutions at association, conference meetings, and General Assembly. And that still makes up the work that we still do today. And we also have clergy and leaders in churches with capacity and knowledge and skills and that are actively engaged in the work of justice. And we also have those who are on the other end of the polar opposite. We have those who have no knowledge, no skills, no capacity, and often those who do not see the work of justice as a part of who we are called to be as people of faith. But among that work that is happening, at least prior to 2019, there was very little coordination, collaboration, or connection to churches, to the wider church, both associations, conferences, and the national setting. Our impact was minimal. It was slow in most instances. And we had no effective way to identify who was doing the work of justice. We had no effective way to organize and mobilize those who were passionate about doing the work of justice to take action collectively as the United Church of Christ, as the Central Atlantic Conference, as Potomac, Shenandoah, Catoctin, New Jersey, and Chesapeake Association. And oftentimes the work that we did do when we did it oftentimes did not happen in our name and was not centered around a particular identity of being the church. You may ask, where did all of this come from? This came from me spending time when I started back in 2015 in this role as your associate conference minister, doing one-on-ones, going and having conversations with pastors, with local church leaders and members, with groups of people, with association leaders, to learn about the state of justice work in our conference. This is also some of the things that I learned. I learned that, you know, of course, we are covered in the five different regions, and I'll speak to that a little bit more. We had five associations, three of which cover the state of Maryland, which we have sort of our large portion of churches. At that time, we had two associations that had standing committees at the association level or task forces that focused on trying to facilitate the work of justice and witness across the association. And we still have those today in New Jersey and the Potomac Association. And that there was no conference-wide sort of team of leaders sort of coming together to be in conversation, to be in community, to strategize, to coordinate our collective work as a church across this region and in our local communities. But as we know, a new way forward is always possible, and sometimes it's necessary when we are presented with new challenges and new realities. And the work of justice in the conference has been adapting over the last 3 years to the current realities and needs that we're facing as local churches and what we're seeing in our local communities. And we're trying our best to respond better to these challenges, to these opportunities, to these possibilities, and to lead in bold and new ways. That's why we're here today. That's why you are here today. And we're also trying to maximize the gifts that are present within our local churches and also equip leaders with the capacity and skills and tools to be effective justice leaders, all for the purpose of having a transformative impact and creating lasting change. The reality is we cannot rely upon our previous model exclusively at the expense and the opportunity of doing something new. And that's what the Justice and Witness Action Network is positioning us to do something new, to be a justice movement of justice leaders, clergy, and local churches who are building and organizing power to secure a just and compassionate world for all. We want our network to be powerful. We want to be faithful. We want to be impactful. And we want to provide you with the skills and the tools necessary to have the impact in your local communities and across this region in ways in which we can look back and be proud and give God praise for the work that has been done. So what does all of this mean? We've talked about throughout this retreat and past gatherings, sort of the elements of our justice work. Many of you have been engaged in our Faith and Democracy campaign, which is emerging as our voting rights, advancement and democracy, issue-based network. So we do civic engagement work. We engage voters to participate in the political process. We also do public policy advocacy. Over the last 2 years, several of our state and regional networks have been active at the state level, influencing public policy. There have been some victories that we're happy to say that we have worked on in partnership with other like-minded organizations in the state. We have been building power. That has been at the core of everything we have been doing going as far back as 2017, when we did a soft launch of the network and began signing up people to join the Justice and Witness Action Network. As you know, many of us are prophetic at nature. That's it. That's our gifting. That's something that we're called to do. And many of us are bringing our prophetic voice to bear, as well as being active in bringing our bodies to bear for the sake of justice by showing up to marches, by showing up to rallies, by speaking truth to power. So that is at the heart of our work as well. And then community organizing. We cannot exclude that. We cannot dismiss that. At the heart of community organizing is being in deep relationship with one another. It's about building power. It's about understanding impacted people's agency and ability to bring their own power to bear, to change their own situations, and partnering with them for collective change that we are seeking in our communities and for their situations. So this is at the heart of what we are looking to do as the Justice and Witness Action Network moving forward. This is the elements of our justice work. We talked about our structure a little bit. Many of you are already actively engaged in our structure as a network, because the way the Central Atlantic Conference is viewed on the map, it's important from a power perspective and from a strategic perspective that we unite by regions, by states. If we are going to try to influence policymakers and those who have power in our local communities to bring about change. So we are trying our best to organize by state and regional networks. Washington, DC and Virginia are one of, right now, are our strongest state and regional networks of the network as a whole. They are active. They have an organizing team led by co-chairs who are facilitating the work of justice among churches and justice leaders and clergy who are participating collectively to bring about change around a set of priorities. So for those of you who are in that region and have not connected with those individuals, you will have an opportunity to do that a little bit later. And then we're hoping to build out state and regional networks in our other three jurisdictions, including Maryland, New Jersey, and yes, Delaware. We talked a little bit yesterday about our issue-based networks. These are the six that are actively functioning at some level. We recognize that some already have leadership teams that are coordinating the work and engaging and doing outreach within the network, particularly amongst our churches and justice leaders and clergy, to be engaged about shaping our agenda as an issue-based network of the conference. And then there are others who I view as an issue-based network, but have not come together yet to recognize that there are other like-minded people within the Central Atlantic Conference doing the same work, and that there are opportunities for us to be in relationship, to learn from one another, and to do this work together and no longer in isolation. And this doesn't, even though these six are up here on the screen, this doesn't preclude the emergence of any new issue-based networks. It really all depends upon where leaders are located and their passion and energy and ability to come together to organize together. And we as a Justice and Witness Action Network, both staff and team, look forward to working with those who are interested in exploring what it would look like to create something new in regards to an issue-based network. We've talked a lot about power so far, and I just want to sort of remind us and ground us this morning as a network. Our power comes through our covenant relationships, through our faith, our relationship with God, our relationship with Christ, our relationship with the Holy Spirit, our relationship with one another as people of faith called to do the work of justice, as local churches working together as an organizing base, as an organizing unit. There's power in every local church to have an impact and bring about change in their local communities if they choose to, but also to do that in partnership with other local churches in their communities. And we can never forget that we have to cast aside this old paradigm that used to be so heavily present in the church, seeing ourselves as the savior of impacted people. No, we are called to be in relationship with them, understanding who they are, understanding their needs, their challenges, and respecting their agency, their leadership, their power to bring about their own change, and connecting up our power with them, so that we can have the ability to do something greater than we can in isolation and disconnected from one another. I also believe that our power is living into our identity as a united and a united justice movement working together. and as the United Church of Christ. This is who we are in this region. The United Church of Christ is not just the national staff in Cleveland or those that are dispersed in other regions of the country. The United Church of Christ at the heart is the local church, the local representation of the denomination. We are the United Church of Christ. We are also the Central Atlantic Conference. We are also our associations. Living into our identity is critically important, not isolating ourselves just as this local church over here in Virginia, this church over here in New Jersey, or this church over here in Maryland or in Delaware. And to recognize that we need to live into our identity based upon the vision and mission and principles that we discussed yesterday. That's critically important because that shapes and determines and grounds us in our collective work together. And then I always like to say we can do more and have a greater impact working together than disconnected and being isolated from one another. We are one. We need to begin to see ourselves as one organization. One organization. Our power is also in the way in which we take action. There's a reason why action is in the name of who we claim to be, the Justice and Witness Action Network. Yes, charitable responses are good. They only, however, meet the immediate need. But we must go beyond that. It's not enough, and it doesn't go far enough to really address the systemic challenges and issues that people are facing. Will the church ever not do charity work? No. We will always do charity work. It's at the heart of who we are, responding to immediate crises and emergencies. But we must never let that be the totality or that exclusively define our justice work. Our justice response must be seeking the root causes of suffering and injustice, analyzing and addressing the systemic factors, building power. So again, I'm going to sound like a broken record, to have a transformative impact and to create lasting change. That's what our justice response needs to be. One of our own leaders in the national setting, Reverend Tracy Blackman, she says it like this: silence in the face of injustice is never an acceptable response from people of faith. Biases is not the business of the church. Love is. Our justice work must never be relegated to just proclamation in word only. We must take action. So what does all of this look like in action? So when you look at how we're sort of organized in the Central Atlantic Conference, we have justice leaders. And I view these as individual members of local churches. Then we have clergy. These are our ordained ministers. They're either serving churches or they're in some specialized ministry setting doing what they believe God has called them to do. And then we have local churches, communities of people of faith working together to live into God's beloved community. This is what makes up the Justice and Witness Action Network. This is all of us. So this works this way. Justice leaders and clergy, signing up to the network. What that means is that now that you are on our list, we know who you are, we know which church you're connected with, we know where you live for the purposes of engaging you and mobilizing you to take action around legislative initiatives that may be happening in the State House or in Congress so that you can hold your elected officials accountable. And we know who you are so that we can begin to connect you with your organizing team of the state and regional action network in which you live. All of this work is grounded in our ability as citizens to be able to hold our elected officials accountable, but also to be in community with our neighbors, with impacted people in our communities to bring about the change that we are seeking. We now know who you are so we can connect you with an issue-based network based upon your passions. Although we're called to be justice leaders, we do have passions around particular issues. And then there's also an opportunity for us, now that we know who you are, we can connect you with your association-based committee who is working to facilitate the work of justice. And one great example of that is how the Potomac Association over the last few years has connected with local churches, clergy, and leaders in their community to build relationships and what that has ultimately served them, how that has served them collectively, is it has brought forth relationships across churches to do ministry together, both in the area of justice and in other areas, but also to have people to rise up and serve in these leadership positions for our state and regional action networks, but also on the association committee to help organize and facilitate the work across their association. How does this work and what does it look like for local churches? Yes, local churches can sign up to the network. We encourage you to sign up local church members in your church to the network. This gives us an opportunity to know who is passionate about the work of justice in your church. And it also gives us an opportunity to be in conversation with you, to connect you back to those individuals, help to facilitate relationships with those individuals, and begin to hopefully build out what we call a justice and witness action team in your local church, who are connecting with us, who are being in relationship with us to do the work of justice. One, through an issue-based network, either through a state or regional action network, and also to connect with the association-based committee who facilitates the work of justice in your association. So what does all of this sort of looks like? So some of us are visual learners, right? And I think Lindsay gave us an initial visual last night of how we move from the one-on-ones, having conversations with individuals to branching and building that out to something larger than just two people. So for one-on-ones, if you're doing one-on-ones in the context of your local church, and many of you sort of caught on real quickly yesterday that one-on-ones are effective not just to do the work of justice, they're effective in a whole lot of ways to really building community and to doing ministry and mission. We hope and pray that through the one-on-ones that we do and that you would do in your local church, that this would lead to us building a much more stronger organizing and power base in local churches through local church justice and witness action teams. And then with you being there organized and connected with us, hopefully you are engaging your local church in the work of justice in many different ways through education, through advocacy work, through organizing, et cetera, et cetera. And then we hope that those local church action teams or the churches through their local church action teams are connecting with our state action networks and issue-based networks. And out of the work that's coming through those state and regional networks and those issue-based networks comes campaigns and initiatives. Now you may think, wow, that's kind of hard to visualize, that's kind of hard to see. So I'm going to provide you with an example this morning, an example that I've been using amongst our leadership members who make up the network right now. So we have Montgomery County, Maryland, and we have several UCC churches in Montgomery County. And for those who don't know, in the context of state legislative work and state public policy advocacy work, the Montgomery County delegation, those elected officials that have been voted to serve the people of Montgomery County in the State House in Annapolis, Maryland, that is a very strong and very influential and powerful legislative group. We have five to six churches in Montgomery County, Maryland. Can you imagine if we were able to get Westmoreland Congregational UCC in Bethesda, Maryland, Christ Congregational UCC in Silver Spring, Pilgrim UCC in Wheaton, Maryland, Bethesda UCC in Bethesda, UCC of Seneca Valley in Germantown, and Rockville United in Rockville. Those six churches, can you imagine what we can do if we had those six churches deeply engaged in prioritizing the work of justice? Not only that, that they each had a local church justice and witness action team that was helping to engage their church in the work of justice in their state, in their county, and in their state. And can you imagine if those churches came together to strategize, to plan, and collectively set a set of priorities to work on issues together? Can you imagine how much they can influence that Montgomery County delegation to the state legislative House in Annapolis on issues that impact Marylanders across the state. And I have to say, unfortunately, that those six churches right now are not engaged and in community together for the work of justice. But that is our goal. I'm not calling them out. I'm just using that as an example so that you can see how we're trying to organize and connect our collective work and presence together in these state regions. Here's another visual. Once you're in your state action networks here at the center, these state action networks are seeking to connect with not just local church justice and witness, local churches through their local church justice and witness action teams. They're looking to connect with justice leaders or clergy. Now, truth be told, this is the reality of what we experience in our churches in the Central Atlantic Conference. As I stated earlier, we have churches as a collective that who do not engage in the work of justice, who do not believe that we are called to be to do the work of justice as a people of faith. But within those churches, you have individual justice leaders or clergy who believe the latter, or who believe differently. They believe we're called to be the work of, to do the work of justice. We're called to be a people of faith. And we are providing an opportunity for them to connect with the larger United Church of Christ outside of their church's ability or desire to engage in the work of justice, to do the work of justice together. So we're creating community for them to do the work of justice. As the state action networks do this work, they have the opportunity to connect not just with local churches through the justice and witness action teams and justice leaders and clergy within our churches, but also coalition partners and other clergy out in the public who are doing the work of justice, all to do this work through our campaigns and different initiatives. And then we believe the same through our issue-based network as well. It's the same model, it's the same operation, how we visualize and see ourselves operating. Most of this work right now is happening in the context, for example, through our racial justice network. We have been doing specific outreach to local churches, to clergy, and to justice leaders to learn about the extent of their racial justice work within their churches and the work that they do in and around their local communities. And from that gathering of information, we've been able to build relationships, determine how best to approach churches in doing the work of justice, and that's helped us in the development of our resources that we talked about earlier. So just to close this out, our minister for this morning talked about the importance for us to connect and not have the few to do the work of many. And I believe in the concept of the power of many, the many, all of us coming together to do the work of justice. We're all called to do the work of justice. We may have our own unique gifts and own unique callings in terms of doing this work and do this ministry, but our collective power lies in all of us coming together to do this work. So let me stop. Let me see, Lindsay, do we have time for questions, if that's allowed in our schedule? If not, I think we are going to be moving into our state and regional action networks for planning, for strategizing, for prioritizing.
Well, I think thank you, Marvin, and amen to all of that. And thank you, everyone. I do think that we still need to take a little break just to let everyone stretch, you know, do whatever you need to do. So what we'll do is we'll take a break, and then because we did build in some time at the end, I think that you think we could do our regional breakouts from 10:30 to 11:30. Does that work? Great. So we're going to take an 11 minute break, and then when we come back, we'll organize you into our regional teams. And in the meanwhile, enjoy your break, and we look forward to seeing you in 11 minutes. So as we all come back, we'll be using this next hour for time within each region. So Marvin's created some breakout rooms, and we'll be going into the region in which we live, and then our In each region, your co-chairs will help guide or leaders will guide the conversation, and you can use this time for planning for whatever you need for the regional action to kind of connect more deeply together as a group. I also want to take this time just to remind particularly the groups in Maryland, Virginia, and DC that the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee has some funds seated for each of those groups within our the Potomac Association. And so for Maryland, DC, and Virginia, we do have funds available to do this work. So that's part of the connection between the association committees, and that we can kind of use the structure of the UCC and our association structure to kind of support this work at a conference level.
Thank you, Lindsay, for explaining that. And we hope that for the other associations can learn from what the Potomac Association has modeled in supporting both through finances, through training, through relationship building, in similar ways to support the churches in your association and justice leaders and clergy to be engaged in this collective justice and witness action network. This is your network. This is our network. Just wanted to, before we open up the rooms, just mention one thing. We know that there are not a lot of individuals here in New Jersey, partly because the New Jersey Association is having their fall gathering today at this particular moment. I will open up the room, but if there are a few of you who are there, two or three that are gathered, go ahead and be in conversation with one another about what would it look like for you and your local church to be engaged in the Justice and Witness Action Network and how to engage leaders in the New Jersey Association to support this justice movement. I would say the same thing for Delaware. I know that we only have a few churches in Delaware, but we did create a room just out of respect and honoring their presence, their voice, and desire to do this work. So if you're here, if it's two or three, I would encourage you to be in conversation in the same way and begin to sort of prioritize and plan out, if it's possible, what will be the focus of your 2023 work. At this time, I'm going to open up the rooms.
Welcome back, everyone. So we hope you all enjoy your time in the breakout rooms. And we'd like to take some time to report back. Just what struck you in each room. So I'll start with DC.
Thank you. Wow. We did a brief overview of the work that we've done thus far in housing justice and gave focus on two key issues. One related to the proposal that we are developing that speaks to conversion of retail commercial space in downtown DC for homeless services program. And for those who had not already heard about the program, it was very well received and we felt some affirmation on that. And we got some suggestions of people and organizations to contact, and we got a couple more worker bees. So we're real happy about that. The other thing that we gave some focus to is what's happening in the Shaw community, particularly around the property that has a legacy with the Lincoln Westmoreland affordable housing program that was developed in the late 60s, early 70s. There's a portion of that property that has been purchased now by a developer that has a horrible track record and is doing horrible things in that community. And so we did talk about some of the action steps that we may want to pursue to make some improvements for those who are still there and hopefully even change some of the development framework as we go forward.
Great, thank you, Vivian. That's awesome. And it's one of the things that we've been wanting to do as a Justice and Witness Committee is to integrate just some of the works, the groups that the committee has funded and with the work that we're doing on justice and kind of bring all those. And so, and Shaw Community is a group that we've been proud to support for a long time. So it's exciting to see that connection being made. And thank you to Judy and Serena for all your work. Let's go to Virginia.
Yes, we had a brief overview about what we did in the last General Assembly, and we started talking about the issues that are of interest to the various churches that were there are passionate about. We were able to confirm that there's a consensus that we will continue to work on the issue to limit the use of solitary confinement in Virginia. And so that will, there's no question we're going to move forward on that issue. But we heard of other issues of interest to churches. People will do some looking into if there's action on those issues. The two biggest ones were education and affordable housing. If there are things that we can effectively on one of those issues be involved in the General Assembly, then we will look into that further, and particularly what coalition we might be work with. So we're going to meet January 9th to finalize our issue and develop strategy. And so that's what we worked on.
Awesome, thank you. How about let's hear from New Jersey? Well, oh, sorry. I didn't mean New Jersey. I meant Maryland.
Okay.
I'll leave our Delaware, New Jersey group for last.
Okay. And I was still talking, I got cut off, but I want to thank the group that came together from Maryland. I think really very enlightening as well as motivating. I felt there is hope in Maryland. I think Marvin set the tone before the breakout session when he used the example of Montgomery County and the impact that it could have in with the Maryland legislature. But we started off, first of all, we wanted to know what gifts and resources we had in the room. And so we went around and we talked about the experience of individuals as well as their desires. What would they like to see happen? And we got some interesting things because many of them are currently or have been working on the environmental issue, racial justice issues, so forth. And so we wanted to capture that and say, how can we galvanize? Someone used the term that we were ripe for galvanizing. And so the conversation turned to how can we galvanize and what should we do? We did that in a brainstorming format without any structure. And so the next step is to put structure to those ideas, but we did come together and sort of reach a consensus that we could use the environmental issue to maybe get us started because there are various components to that environmental issue. That includes a racial justice issue. And then we were very fortunate to have with us Keisha, who works down in Annapolis, who gave us some information about what is on the horizon that perhaps we could galvanize around. But the strategy and all, we talked about several things. One, giving people the information, our congregations the information, and educating them about the issues, and then moving to issues that were not so threatening to some people, and then easing them into those difficult topics or topics that may be more difficult for some people. We also talked about maybe the reproductive rights, which is going to be a big issue because there's so many components to that. There's the health issue, medical services issue, there's the economic issue, who has access to what kinds of things and so forth. So we're on our way. Our next step is to, we did form a nucleus group to put together, take all of this information, and let's then see how we can organize it, how we can roll it out to get the participation and the collective participation of the churches in Maryland so that we will have a Maryland network. Did I forget anything, Fiend, who took notes? Did I forget anything?
No, I think you did a great job.
I would add to what Irma said that, one, thank you, Irma, for your leadership in leading that session. I think it's good that we were able to come together with all that you mentioned. We also talked briefly about the one-on-ones and the need to be very intentional about how to do that. The several of our associations had already done some one-on-ones previously back in 2021 and a few earlier this year. So we want to build off of those and do some new ones, being strategic about connecting with churches who we know have an appetite for doing the work of justice.
Great. That's so exciting to see energy coming from Maryland. That's wonderful. For our final group, we had the small remnant group of from New Jersey and one from Delaware. And then I hung out just to see what was going on in each. But either of you want to share anything from our session, Cynthia or Clara?
Just it's important to organize no matter where you are. And you know, even if there aren't many UCC churches in your area, there are other folks who are there who want to get together and work together on justice issues. And so that's what we do in Newark is we have lots of faith communities who are getting together to work right now on affordable housing in the city of Newark.
I'm looking forward to the resources that this group is working on even now, especially around anti-racism and ways that we can educate ourselves as a congregation and begin the process of becoming more active.
Great. And I think that, yeah, there's a lot to learn from DC, the DC housing justice work for housing justice, and then a lot to learn from the racial justice network in terms of racial justice. So just ways that we can resource each other and share across, across regions is how this all works. I turn it over to Marvin to close, I wanted to also just highlight that the Justice and the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee, we've been really trying to kind of support the infrastructure of this network, the regional networks. And so just Vivian and Leslie and Irma are all members of our Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee. Two things. One, I'd love to see it go beyond the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee, and obviously it is already, and it's great to see the expanded, the number of folks outside the Potomac Association on this call. And if anyone is interested in joining anyone who's in the Potomac Association and is interested in joining our committee, we would love to have you there. I'll be stepping down as chair in April. Vivian and Leslie are coming to the end of their term. So we are looking for that next generation of leadership. And if you're in the Potomac Association and want to be involved in this work, I'm putting my email in the chat and we'd love to hear from you. Leslie, go for it.
Yeah, I just had one more thing that I forgot to put in my report that I think is useful, and that is we really noted that the discussion this morning about inclusion of the impacted community and engaging with them so that we do more grassroots efforts with the impacted communities. And that's one thing we're going to try and work on in Virginia as we go forward on our issues.
That's great. Leslie, thanks for saying it. And thank you for your words, Lindsay. I want to first apologize to the Catoctin Association. I failed to mention them in my presentation earlier, although in the context of my presentation, I was discussing what was happening prior to 2019. But I've spent a considerable amount of time with Reverend Rebecca Schillingberg and other clergy and lay leaders to build out their racial justice group that now is an emerging justice team of the Catoctin Association. So I want to just celebrate the leadership and those individuals coming together to do the work of justice together and to do the tough work of being in relationship and having one-on-ones with churches and clergy and leaders across the Catoctin Association. So thank you, Rebecca, for your leadership and to all the others who you know you are who have been doing this work for some time. Thank you to the Potomac Association Justice and Witness Committee. You all have served as a base to build out this Justice and Witness Action Network. And as Lindsay and Lizzie has discussed for some time, it was just Potomac folks. But we've appreciated their leadership in helping us to build this network beyond Potomac. And that was our intentions. We were intentional about starting in Potomac and building out of Potomac. So as we move further out, we will be engaging more. And I'm hoping that at some point, as Lindsay made her pitch for those of you who are in the Potomac Association to serve on their association committee to help facilitate and support the work that's happening in the association, we are looking for leaders at the conference level for the network who can sort of help look from the mountaintop view and sort of figure out how do we keep this justice movement growing in many different ways, but also building and doing the work of justice together. We do have at our board of directors level in the conference a committee that does that work. They serve a different function, but I think they also can work to help build this network in a similar way that you all are doing by being here today. As a final word of thanks and next steps, I think the important thing for all of us to do in moving forward is to continue to be in prayer about the work that we are doing together and ask God to continue to unite us and to reveal to us those who are in our communities who have an appetite and a passion for justice. But for whatever reason, maybe a little hesitant, a little scared to move into that place of leadership because of whatever concerns that they may have. And I'm reflecting upon Jennifer's conversation or thoughts she shared in the Maryland breakout session that she has some of those individuals in her congregation. And I'm pretty sure there are others in our congregations. Let's build community. Let's provide a safe space to honor their voice, their agency, and encourage them to join this collective movement and what it means for us to live out our faith. As a next step, we also have the public folder for this retreat, all of the resources that are there right now. We're going to update some of those and add to that. I'm going to put it back in the chat so that you can have that link. And know that as part of my role and commitment as director of the Justice and Witness Action Network, in 2023, I'm going to be doing one-on-ones in a similar fashion that I did years ago to get us to this point. And I'm open to having conversations with local churches who have some form of committee or group, whatever you call it, that is tasked with doing the work of justice. I want to have conversations with those committees, those teams as well, to just listen, to learn who they are, to build a relationship, and pray that it would lead to us working together to do the work of justice. So if you are one of those churches, do not hesitate to reach out to me. My email is being put in the chat right now, and I'm pretty sure many of you know how to reach me. So reach out to me and we can schedule a time to have that conversation with your team and your local church. Finally, just a word of thanks to all of you for your commitment, for your time this weekend. You could have been anywhere else, but you chose to be here with us, and I don't take that lightly. I say thank you. So let me close out with the final benediction and a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for community and how you knit us together each and every day to be a part of this beloved community called the United Church of Christ in this area of the country that we call the Central Atlantic Conference. For such a time as this to do this ministry that we call the Justice and Witness Action Network. Continue, O dear God, to pour out your spirit upon us. Lead us, O dear God, in all that we have lifted up and shared this weekend. Know that we are prepared to answer the call, not just for the sake of the call, but for one another, because we love one another. And we cherish what each and every one of us brings to this ministry, to this community together. Give us faithfulness, give us courage, and give us, oh dear God, the words that we need so that when we leave this place to engage in the follow-up conversations, the one-on-ones with those in our local churches, that you will speak to us and through us to reach those, oh dear God, who are called to be a part of this expression of faith in this time, this Justice and Witness Action Network. We give you praise and we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.